times, and what is the requirement of the society. Of late, this issue of mental strength, personality development, as to whether they are correlated or not, is always an issue which we everyone realize that it is important, because I was talking to Mr. Nilesh outside the platform and with Mugda ma'am and Dr. Harish Shetty also, that how everything is related with the mind. Once the mind is strong, then the personality is correlated. They say that it's the mind is in fact the entire, the seed which actually converts into a plant or a tree. So therefore, the mental strength of the mind is more paramount. We have done a lot of webinars and invariably we introduce everyone. But today I felt that it's wherein we are talking of the mental strength and the personality development. So to introduce a person whose resume speaks for itself, but sometimes you feel that you will not be able to do the justice, the amount of what actually is the main key point. In the Google, etc., you find something special. But the common point, which, as we say in the law also, that the common thread running between these three speakers is that they are doing a tremendous job as to how the mind is to be strengthened up. And irrespective of that fact, it is directly proportional to your personality development. Amongst us, we have Dr. Harish Shetty, who is a well-known person. He has been contributing, not as a psychiatrist, but also in the legal affairs by taking petitions, giving his drafts. He has been teaching in the judicial academies. Then we have amongst us Mugda Bavre. She's a co-founder of Disha as well as Mind Sports. I thought that the name was at least very good in the relevance of our theme. It's beyond law. So we said that the Disha could only be given when we are in the right direction of having a mind development. And the mind sport is that because it says that it all lies in the mind. So when the mind is healthy in the sports of the mind, if they are in the healthy perspective, it gives a different direction. Therefore, the Disha and the mind sports are interwoven to each other. You cannot have a mind sports without a direction, and there cannot be any direction without there is a mind sport which is going in. Then we have Mr. Nilesh Kulkarni, who is a sports player, 20 years of cricket, and making his own niche. As they say that it's even better if you have a one day of major highlights of the life, which gives you a good days and years to live. The first ball we will take from Mr. Nilesh Kulkarni, first ball and the debut and taking the wicket. That itself gives the mindset a right perspective and a right personality. And I think he created his own niche in the cricket, but he thought that he has one way of would be Mr. Kulkarni, after having retired from the sports, laying back, saying that he could have done much, much better. There were many opportunities, but he thought, no. The best way to pay back to the society is to contribute. They say if you create good nurseries, automatically the good plants come. And when good plants come, they invariably, some of them also become trees, and which gives the shade. And as they say, each one, plant one. So all three of them are contributing and planting different seedlings in their own way so that the society is better. As I said, that I will not introduce in the right perspective except for the trailer. They say, ye toh abhi trailer hai, picture abhi baki hai. So I will ask them to speak two lines. What are the best things what they have put towards the society? Then we will ask each one to speak on the... Ma'am, I'm not audible. Is it audible?
Yeah. Yes.
Mr. Nathan, you will have to check it at your end. And rest can also pitch in as to whether it's audible or not. Yes, Mr. Nathan, you will have to log in again. Rest can also just send a text irrespective of any speaker when they are speaking. If there is any audibility issue, we will see as to whether it can be done. I can also tell the speakers. But I am receiving the message that it's audible. And at least the three speakers, it's a rare occasion where you are asking the speakers to listen to them. It's the only moderator that has the key to do that. Rest are all locked down with everybody being muted. So two things, then we will ask everyone to have a different perspective, how that mind development, mind personality and personality development are different facets which are correlated with each other. they have their existence separately and also coexisting together. I will ask Mr. Harish Sethi first to say two, three things about his own project, then Mr. Then Mugda ma'am and then Nilesh, then we will set the ball into motion. Over to you, Dr. Sethi.
My name is Dr. Harish Sethi. I practice psychiatry in Bombay. I work with people and my patients. Largely, I work with the youth. I work in the community across the country with different groups. And my main activity is to spread awareness of mental health in every Indian across the country.
Yeah. Hello, everybody. It's a good opportunity to come here and talk to all of you regarding this topic. So my name is Mugda, and I'm basically a sports psychologist. But before being a sports psychologist, I call myself as a counseling psychologist because that is how I started my practice 20 years back in the field of psychology. But being an athlete, being a sport person myself, I thought that I should give back something to the sporting community. And 20 years back, it was a kind of a very new field. So I thought of stepping into the field and taking advantage of being an athlete and contributing it to the field back. So now currently I work with all the elite athletes, especially who are into different sports, as well as grassroots level athletes. So that's where I am almost all the time with the athletes around me.
That's fantastic. Mr. Nilesh, we can say that back to back, it's like when I'm calling upon Nilesh to speak something, I'm just reminded that it is like cricket, all three balls consecutively taking a wicket. It's a enjoyment. And once there are three speakers back to back, hearing them itself is a treat to everyone. Over to you, Nilesh.
Incidentally, this is my batting order as well. So I'm in the right order. But hello, everyone. It's an absolute pleasure. I've had a fairly decent career of first-class cricket, playing for Mumbai and for India a little bit. And then I've had a decent run of introducing India's first sports management institute, which we have completed 10 years in our existence. The reason I'm actually excited to interact here is I personally feel I'm actually qualified to talk about mental health and a failure acceptance, because sport has given me that edge and a leverage, because we have failed many a times before we have succeeded, and our success percentage is less. But what we've learned from our failure and how we've applied it in our workplace is something I'll be sharing with you, which possibly will give you an understanding of how we think from a negative to positive, and how as sports people you try and accept and overcome all these mental health challenges.
Thank you, Nilesh. Before we trigger off for the entire this thing, I was just reading that Dr. Sethi is a psychiatrist and Mugda ma'am is a psychologist. I was just thinking, and even Google was saying there's so much overlapping between the two, and it is very difficult to segregate the two. We will, during the course of the session, we'll ask them to explain what is the subtle difference between the psychiatry and psychologist, because invariably people say that if you're going to a psychologist, you are under depression, or he's understanding this. And same as with the psychiatry. What is the subtle difference between both of you? You will decide as to who will explain the difference, or you will explain with yourself.
I think Mugda will explain the difference. Mugda, go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, there is also a subtle difference, or I would say quite a big difference, because especially when we talk about the qualification, it needs a different kind of a qualification for both the fields, because psychiatry needs obviously a medical background, and then it's done at a master's level. But psychology is where we have an arts background and then we do our post-graduation in psychology. That's a basic difference that I would say between these two fields. Another difference is, a major difference I would say, is obviously psychiatrists are qualified to prescribe even the medication, and they do work with maybe higher level mental illnesses, whereas psychology or clinic counseling psychologists especially, we work with normal day-to-day problems that everybody faces in their workplace, in their personal life. So that's what I feel is a major difference.
Probably Dr. Sethi is saying it's not audible. Dr. Sethi is not audible. Okay, it's fine. So we will ask all three of you to just pitch in for around 10 minutes. Meanwhile, we will have, it's a more like an interactive session. It cannot be like what webinars we have been holding. It's not it will be an education in a different way. As they say that sometimes you have to be just studying and sometimes it's an overlapping, that you also learn while playing. So today it will be learning in a subtle manner of while not playing in the right perspective, but yes, playing with the words, playing with the thought processes, how to make a good mind process, and then how to make it a good personality development. I would also request, when three of you are doing this thing, we would like that how you actually, somebody who came down with psychologically or was under a depression, or Mr. Kulkarni, a sports player, also feel that they were doing well, but on the D-Day when it actually mattered, he failed. But how did he do well? I will ask Mr. Nilesh to explain how that Sri Lankan player, Marwan Attupattu, 00, then for this thing. So we will all take all those questions, but question and answers can will be taken up after around 30-35 minutes. Over to you, Dr. Harish Shetty.
Well, I would like to locate the challenges in today's era, and that I think is very important. I saw my parents at 5 p.m. in the evening, but my children see me at 11 o'clock at night. That's the difference between the two eras. And I used to walk back from my school, and I used to see cycles and motorbikes stopping, talking. I used to also see bullock carts stopping, talking. But now I cannot walk back to my clinic. I have to take a vehicle. I can't walk. There's no place to walk. The third most important thing, which is very, very big, is I do not enter a house after entering three or four houses. Kaisa hai, kya hai? I have to enter my house because I can't go to anybody's house without giving a call, without taking an appointment, without going in. So these are the big changes which are happening around us. And we see these big changes happening around us. The most important skill for all human beings, for any development, whether it's delicious sports or anything, is building emotional wealth. What is depleted in the 21st century is the emotional energy. You run here, you run there, you catch a train, you go there, you don't know what's happening. And at the end of the day, there's no energy for people to talk to each other whom they love. So what is very important is building emotional wealth is one of the most important keys to really helping you flower and helping you grow. And that, I think, is important. That's number one. Number two is that as children 30 years ago, 35 years ago, we were connected very easily. As I've said, if everybody understands, and I'm sure Nilesh is from my state of Maharashtra, and he will understand, that tabhi hamare gharon mein kadi thi, kadi. और हम कड़ी हम किसी के भी घर में जाते थे और वो खाना एक्सपेक्टेड था. ऐसा नहीं क्या था कि लोग कहेंगे खाना का कैसा, एक्सपेक्टेड था कि आप खाओ और वहां से निकल जाओ. फिर क्या हुआ, फिर वो डोर एक तरफा, वन डोर, इट फोल्डेड लाइक दिस, इट डिड नॉट फोल्ड लाइक दिस, इट फोल्डेड लाइक दिस. फिर वहां एक बेल आ गया कि हम धक्के मार के नहीं उसको ओपन कर सकते हैं, वो बेल बजा के ओपन करना चाहिए. देन व्हाट हैपेंड, द सेकंड डोर केम. And there came a keyhole. That is a shift which happened across time. And then what came was a man on the ground floor, on the ground, asking you, aapko kahan jana hai? So many times I would say, my chor hoon, then they would allow me to go those days. And then what happened, which is extremely important, is that the man down who would stop you said, ki, my phone karunga if they would allow you to come. Then came the camera. So what has happened across time is we slowly became disconnected. Disconnection is the biggest illness in the 21st century. So first is building emotional wealth, and second is building connectivity is the most important thing for personality growth, as both of them would always say, that you need connection and learning to work as a team in cricket or in life. It is the connectivity where you have to learn to work as a team in spite of you having lot of differences between each other. In cricket, tumne mere ko sala out kyon kiya, maine kaha tha ek hi run lo, tu dusra kyon aaya bhagte, main out hua. So building connectivity, that's the big challenge. Third thing which is again very important is beyond emotional energy and emotional connectivity is building emotional equity. Us zamane mein sab ek jaise the, hum sabhi se baat karte the, wo watchman ho ya wo principal ho ya koi hierarchy itna nahi tha. In my school, we were all together. I mean, there was no hierarchy among people. We didn't mind if somebody was rich or poor. And there was an equitable relationship. There were hardly any barriers. The number of groups was not many. But as of now, what has happened is the hierarchy of living, how people of communities has moved across time. And building equitable relationship with people is something which is extremely important for building your personality. But one thing which was bad at that time was we could not tell our parents, I love you. Ivan Maitas no the Kai love to come on to English. Logongo Patayne the Kai love lo Hamari Hamara responsibility Hamadati Kaikas may love love care. So, wo jo hamare ma pitaji the jo who were born before independence, they were more stoic. We were born after independence, we became a little more open. We started opening our emotions. And now the kids of now will not sleep before they tell their mother that I love you. The expression of feelings also improved in the last 25 years, 30 years. And the fourth most important thing is India started sharing its feelings, which is very important for personality growth. The next two things again, which are very, very crucial is, okay, we learn to share feelings, okay? We started the stoic generation in the era of struggle. We came to the second generation, the consolidated the era of struggle. Jo maa baap ne ghar bandha, usko humne thoda paint mara. And the third PD is era of pleasure. Tumne jo kuch banaya, hum aish karenge. So as we started sharing our feelings, we also started to learn that we can share our problems. When we were young, we would not share our issues about our family with friends so easily. But atta mula saral government maza baba pito, my father drinks a lot, salao pike mere maa ko marta, and they share each other so openly. They share the feelings so that they ask for help. And the fourth most important thing to really to build a personality is help seeking behavior. Mujhe himmat hai, main madad mangunga, mujhe koi sharam nahi hai. I'm not ashamed to ask for help. That I think is the most important tool for building person. The last thing is, main sampann hu ya main nahi hu, main complete hu ya incomplete hu, aur sabhi incomplete hai, we're all incomplete human beings. Main dusron ke liye kuch na kuch karunga. Compassion and kindness. And if we have these five things inside our bowl, in our mind and our zehn mein hai, hamara man aur sharir aapas mein isko khata hai, peeta hai aur usse aish karta hai, तो मुझे लगता है you are reasonably a well-rounded personality. You have the ability to relate, to seek help, to ask for help, to share, and also to give in life. I think these are the attributes which are extremely essential to build somebody's personality. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Harish. In the era of SMS, there couldn't be more short message which was actually sweet, which could hammer the point in the right perspective. They say that hammering the nail in the right direction is important. And I personally feel that the session has been set into motion in the right way. We'll ask Mugdha Bhavre what are her experiences and how she has what she intends, and then how she also motivates by reading the psychology, etc. Over
to you. Yes. My experience, being as I said, being a psychologist, initially I started working with kids, with adolescents and with adults. So my experience was where I used to get more number of problematic cases that they call, you know, if the child is having some kind of an issue, maybe a hyperactive child or maybe an autistic child. So I started dealing initially with these kids. But somewhere later on, as I said, I changed my field into coming into sports. And today's topic, what we are looking at today is mental training and personality development. And then I got this kind of a connection is where sports is so much into where we start building our own personality. And looking at my own experience when I was myself as an athlete for almost 16, 17 years of my life, how it changed my way of thinking, my way of behaving, my entire personality. It's something, an amazing picture which I saw almost 20 years later when I sat on the other side of the table as sports psychologist. So I'm sure that as being a sport person, it really gives a lot, and it has a great connection to what kind of a person you become ultimately. Because even as Nilesh has said earlier, that, you know, we face a lot many failures before we actually experience successes. And right now in this scenario, even as Dr. Shetty has said, there's been a great change what kids and children are going through right now. And unless they know, unless they experience the failures, unless they know how to handle stresses and tensions in life, it's going to be very, very difficult to actually face the world, which is becoming so demanding right now in front of them. So I'm sure sports has a lot to do when it comes to personality building. And it's not only what we are looking at winning or losing, but what we are looking at is even beyond winning and losing. It's the kind of resilience that you tend to build. It's the kind of failures you tend to focus on. You learn how to bounce back from all of these things, and you become a different person altogether. So it's not that when 1,000 people are into sports, not everybody is a winner. Maybe it's just 5 or 6 people who turn out to be winners or champions, but there are rest of the people who learn the lessons of life and are able to better cope with these life situations or maybe stresses of life in a better way.
Thank you, ma'am. The point well taken, that as in the Newton law, they say that to every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction of the same strength. Now that is very relevant, because as they say, if you start depressing, you will create negative vibes and the entire in and around the surrounding that. If your positivity is just like, it's like a bottle of perfume. The moment you open, you need not spread it, it automatically spreads. So good and negative vibes both travel, but it is only the entire endeavor in the society is to build a better society. And as Mr. Nilesh said, sports is one activity. Like in academics, you have quarterly exams, monthly exams, but sports, wherever you are playing, daily you are playing, today you are out, next day you succeed. So the success proportion and the failure proportion in sports is much, much more. Therefore, invariably, the studies say that the sports player are able to cope up this thing, whereas academicians sometimes fail. Because I was reading one of the articles that said that a person who had been throughout gold medalist and he couldn't get promoted one point of time. That was his first failure, and that too at the age of around 35. He just couldn't cope up of that. He couldn't realize that there could be concept of failure also. Whereas in sports, even if you start playing at 10, in the first month itself, you will see success as well as failure. Rather than my speaking, I would ask Mr. Nilesh to put his inputs, because he has seen everything, they say, straight from the horse's mouth.
Thank you. Thank you for this wonderful opportunity, and especially after to speak after Dr. Shetty and Mugdha. You know, you're burdened enough in terms of your mental preparation, what to say and how to say. The good part is, you know, I come from a humble background and I am from vernacular medium. So I studied all my schooling in Marathi. So my first challenge was to understand English and then speak English fluently to communicate. And I had to first, I used to be a shy person. I always had this complex of how I can communicate. But I had only two options. Either just become shy and stay shy for the rest of my life, or I evolve, start learning, start bouncing back, and then start communicating to make friends. And I agree with Dr. Shetty when he narrated a couple of stories. When I started playing cricket for Mumbai, we used to travel in train, buses, and we used to share rooms. So the communication always would have two ways, two different perspectives. Whether we like it, whether we accept it or not, and whether we put a point across or not, you would still have a communication. The concept of single room for a lot of players now has been an absolute dampener and a killer, because you cannot evolve. Whatever you do, is you are thinking is right. But the perspective which can give you some idea of your improvement get stopped. I'll tell you what, you introduce myself, that I got wicket on my first ball in test cricket. But I fielded for 3 days to get my second wicket, and I did not get a second wicket in that same test match. And I fielded for 950 runs against Sri Lanka. For me, that was my learning. Not the first wicket. First wicket was obviously the satisfying thing for any cricketer making his debut for India and, you know, getting a wicket. But the challenge was to put myself into a grind that I belong there at international level and make sure that I broke into Indian team by performing well, and still you don't get a second wicket in the same test match. And in 2 days, the entire Indian team could not get a second wicket. Imagine the mental preparation, the pressure, and you're playing away game. So all these things as part of our learning, you know, it's all about learning. And I will narrate one beautiful thing, which I always share with everybody. Our ex-president, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, beautifully explained the definition of fail. And Mugdha will laugh about it. The fail definition is first attempt in learning. The moment we have a positive approach towards our failure is your crack into that, making sure that you crack the code, because that means you are not thinking about the negativity. You are thinking about, even if you fail, what will you improve? And for me, the real-time sport thing, and I always have this emphasis across all platforms, and I encourage that, that sport is actually a real-time, because we don't have retakes. In any sport, live sport you play, what's gone is gone. If you drop a catch, you are bound to get stick from the crowd, from the captain, from the players. And if that catch is like a Herschel Gibbs catch in the World Cup, you're going to get more stick and it will be there for next 20, 30 years. How do you live with it? Because you can't change it. What you have to find a way is the next opportunity you create. And that's the definition of no. A lot of people talk about no as a negative thing. But if you want to create your opportunity, that's how Herschel Gibbs changed his perspective. He made sure that he bring that positivity by getting the team to win a match against Australia in South Africa. So how do you look at these perspectives? And this is the edge what sport gives you as you're learning. These are real times. You don't have retakes like you were mentioning about academics. You can correct the first semester and better it into second semester. But in sport, every single moment is a real-time moment. So the best part for all these things is your preparation work. How well you prepare yourself, how well you are handling all the different scenarios and situations before you actually go about doing that. You know, for example, a Gagan Narang is shooting for an Olympic gold. The preparation work for him starts 4 years in advance, that he goes through multiple scenarios with multiple situations who he creates for himself before he's thinking about that. So when he's actually doing that, he's just going through the motion, because the pre-context thought which he builds in with multiple failures to get that right bullseye is always a process, how you think of approaching that. And for me, I'm not the expert about talking the psychology or the psychiatry, but what I have experienced as a player, I'm sharing my experience with you, because this helped me. See, you will always be dejected. You will always be down with your failures. It's human psychology. You and me cannot change it. What is in our hand is how we think of quickly turning it around. And it helps when you start playing sport. It helps you overcome that in every moment you encounter. And for me, that is something you should encourage. All that. And as I'm part of one government initiative, central government, where we are coming up with the National Sports Education Board as a policy, and in which we encourage schools to start minimum 2 to 3 sport, and one of them has to be a team sport for their overall development and their learning, which eventually will help address the mental health and the personality development, which is our topic, because that's very, very critical. And for me, because sport does not have retakes, it allows you to prepare better and it allows you to execute that plan, what you believe and what you back is right, in a perfect manner. You will still fail, but at least you will be conscious enough to handle that failure better, because the efforts in which you have given in are more than 100%.
Thank you, Mr. Nilesh. What you said, I was just like, we are having a webinar. I was also looking at, there was an interactive session with Mr. Vivek Atre, who would be doing JP Atre show, and he was talking to Praveen Amre. They said, what was your feeling that when you hit 100? He said that 100, one looks that it is of 6 hours. But the grind behind that 100 was six years behind that. So any success is not a fluke. There has to be a lot of efforts behind it. And what you said, a point well taken, that it's better to try and fail rather than failing to try. So since we are going on a different interactive, I will ask Mukta to ask Mr. Harish what is his key about it, and we can ask Mr. Nadesh. Meanwhile, we can also take the questions. Ma'am, any question from Mr. Harish? How to think positive, how to contribute towards the society? If somebody is depressed, what is his major take in that? You can take the questions in your way.
Okay. Yeah, I think this is the first time I'm asking a question to Dr. Shetty. Okay. So maybe from a sporting background, I would say that you also must have handled certain sport personalities. So what would be your view when there is a person, a sport person, even though he has handled many successes, even experienced failures, and still is in a negative mindset or keeps thinking about failures a lot more than giving best at his processes? What's the kind of approach that you feel as a psychiatrist that you would apply, or how would you help him or her in this situation?
First is acknowledge the failure and respect the failure. It's important to respect the failure.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Very important.
When you respect the failure, you learn from the failure.
Yes.
If you deny the failure, you blame somebody else.
True.
ये सबसे बड़ी बात है तो रिस्पेक्ट द फेलियर माजी लागली सॉरी व्हेन मिस्टर कुलकर्णी इज अ लिटिल मराठी करता ऑटोमेटिकली एंड दैट इज दैट आल्सो आणि इफ यू आर एबल टू रिस्पेक्ट एक्सेप्ट एक्नॉलेज एंड लाफ एट द फेलियर साला मैं कैसा ब्रीफ ऑनरेबल जज के सामने रखा वकील साहब विकास How? What sort of a brief I put? My God! How did I move my bat without moving my feet outside the off stump? And he understands that much better. When you laugh, it becomes the failure does not become part of you. The learning becomes part of you.
It's a point well taken. Like what you said, like Mr. Kulkarni was saying, as a lawyer also, you don't get second opportunity. The preparation, it has to be done at the first instance. You have to argue. You don't get. They say life has only retakes in the cricket matches. Once the player is out, you can see two or three flashback how that there is there. But in the life, you have to just keep on moving. You have to move on with the life and the challenges.
I'm not finished. So, if you remember, Nilesh and Mukta will know, there's a man known as Mohinder Amarnath. And Absolutely. Nilesh knows what I'm going to say. Everybody knows you have to bowl a short ball to him. Because he cannot resist tempting the hook shot. So the difference is, when you respect the failure, when you accept the failure, you learn from that and you know how to position your bat, look around, see the match, at what stage it is, should I hit the hook shot or not, and you don't repeat the mistake. Mohinder would repeat it again and again. So that is the difference. One, if you learn, you don't repeat a mistake. And if you still repeat the mistake, it becomes a habit and that brings you down. I think that is the most important thing for anybody, for Harish Shetty, for Mukta, for Nilesh, for a lawyer, as you say, Vikas. And if we can teach young children in sports academies, in schools, that like, for example, lastly, when Vivek Oberoi shared the other day, when his film flopped, Shashi Kapoor came to his house and said, the film is flopped. You're not failed as an actor. And separating that also, I think, is the key to all change. I though Mukta and Nilesh see more sportsmen than me, but in all areas of life, that would be as a cub lawyer, the new lawyer, when you go behind your senior lawyer and the senior lawyer says, "Aaj mujhe I'm busy in that court. You please present this and you come back." And instead of that, you do exactly the opposite and come back. You're fired in front of everybody else. And that firing firing should spur you to do something more. And that, I think, is the key attribute for every human being.
True. Yes, right, because sir. Yeah, I can actually share some things. As sir has said that, we need to, especially when I work with sports people, it's very important. Rather than even talking about success, what I generally do is I prepare them to handle the threats and adversities that any sport is posing in front of them. Because every sport in its own way has different adversities, whether it is archery, whether it is shooting, whether it is swimming, whether it is cricket, we all have our own different adversities related to that sport. And if you're not prepared to handle the adversities or the threats, it's going to be very difficult, because when we are into sports, obviously the first thing that comes into our mind is, how will I win? How will I come first? How will I defeat this person? How will I defeat the other team? But rather than winning, if we are actually focusing and try to shift the focus onto the excellence-centered approach, that's going to actually help players to even accept the defeats, to even accept the failures, and look at it as a kind of a way where there is a room for improvement. Also, considering what could be the adversities, prepare for the adversities, where I always give an example of Michael Phelps. When he was into 2008 Olympics, and he had already equaled the record of 7 individual gold medals in Olympic. It was his last event, and the fear that he always had in his mind was, what if water seeps into my goggles? And that exactly what happened on the last day of his main event, that was 200 meters butterfly. But since he was, along with his coach, had prepared himself to train for this adversity 3 years prior to the Olympics, he could actually handle the situation very well, because imagine the expectations the entire world was looking at that race. And basically handling that kind of pressure, working in those adversities and still breaking a world record and getting a gold medal is not an easy thing to do for a sport person if he or she is not being trained to handle the adversities.
I think beautifully said.
Beautiful. The example, now I can understand while I'm hearing all three of you, why you three actually change that spirit within that. Rather, I'm feeling, instead of moderator, after this session, I would have a good change thought process, and that is required. Shubham asks Dr. Harish Shetty, isn't sharing feelings, emotions lead to vulnerability, and ultimately people use it against you? What is your suggestion and take on this?
Well, you don't stand on the terrace and share the feelings with the entire world or an entire city. You share the feelings with people whom you trust, love, care, and who are mentoring you. Because that is extremely important. And what is very important, when you share feelings, you build a bond. Say, for example, if Mukta shares his feelings with his son or daughter and says, I'm very angry that you really spilled all this, she's building a bond. She's not creating a wall. So it's extremely important that when you build a bond with your mentor and a coach, as Nilesh is running a sports management company, who's it best? Nilesh, apna Anil Kumble.
Yeah.
Everybody said, what ball turn ne karta hai? Usma ball mein turn hi nahi. And he came back fiercely. He came back fiercely. So many examples we have in different sports. Isn't it? He came back and he said, I will fight Madison. Virat Kohli said something very beautiful in all his interviews, and that I quote for every professional, in any area. It is good to do simple things, though it is very boring every day. Keep doing simple things, even if it's boring. Pick that one and two also. Don't try the extraordinary thing all the time. When you do simple things well, you learn how to do extraordinary things also better. I think I listen to interviews of great people, and I learn from every interview, which is applicable to my own life. And that, I think, is the beauty of people who have really done well. There is no much difference. They rewire their brain, and they stay on the wicket even when the ball is turning, whether the wicket of life or the wicket of cricket. And that, I think, is the beauty. I would want to hear. I've come to hear Mr. Kulkarni and Ms. Mukta.
This time I will ask Dr. Shetty asking a question to Nilesh.
Nilesh, mala tumhala ekach vicharaycha aahe. I want to ask you one thing. Khara sangayche, sir.
Yeah.
You have seen cricketers before you, with you, and after you.
That's right.
What are the three most important things you have learned from cricketers across? You could name them, which is very useful for every Indian at this point of time in life, when we are surrounded by, we have COVID, we have cyclone, we have earthquake in Bhuj, we have earthquake in Delhi, we have China, and we have Nepal.
I think my personal learnings and takeaways from the sports personalities is first and most important thing is control the controllables. Whatever you have, whatever you can do. And I have followed one learning from all these guys. See, you have the geniuses like Sachin Tendulkar and Brian Lara. You know, they are here to do some different service for sports, like Michael Phelps and all the legends of Michael Schumacher. What my takeaways and what I have, what I want to share with you is every piece of learning I have acquired from individuals who I have interacted with. So coming from straight from Sachin Tendulkar, I personally feel God has sent him to do all the miracles on this earth. But when I asked him one question, you know, what is it that one thing you feel is required? And his answer was very simple, because his past was so brilliant and his future is so glorious, which we all know when I was playing with him. He said the toughest thing for him was to stay in the present. And one of the biggest challenges we realize in today's world is we don't live in the present. We only talk about past and we only think about future. We don't think too much about our present and what do we need to do at that point of time. And that's something which we need to overcome during this learning. I will share one more beautiful incident about Steve Waugh. And I was fortunate to play against him, and unfortunately I never got a chance to get him out in a match. I tried 4 to 5 times to bowl at him and never got him out. And I asked him about what is it that you think? He said, my preparation starts that I know that I have my strengths and I have my weaknesses. But I plan for my weaknesses better because I know I can always bank on my strengths. But if I know about my weaknesses, I will not touch upon those things which I'm not good at doing. So like you were mentioning about the hook, like Jimmy Paji, which Steve Waugh never could play a hook or a pull. In 165 test matches of his, he never played a single ball. He got bruises on his body, but he never attempted to play that ball. So he had the ability, the mental strength to make sure that he knew what he's not supposed to do. So his supposed to do things were a lot easier. And for me, that's the beautiful thing. The third example I will give about Anil Kumble. Like you absolutely hit the nail. About Anil Kumble got criticized. He's not a big spinner of the ball. So what? He's got 690 test match wickets for you without spinning a ball. What more certificate do you want from a person who was criticized of not spinning the ball? But he won matches for you. And out of all the top wicket taker, he's the only wicket taker who got 10 wickets in an innings. For me, that's a certificate you cannot buy in the market. He believed in his ability. He took criticism in his strides. And he proved his detractors wrong by his performances. For me, that's a hallmark of a champion who never spoke. And I'll tell you my personal experience when I was playing with Anil Kumble. He was such a brilliant guide. When I made my debut for India in that same test match, Anil was part of it. He would come to you and give you immediate feedbacks on this wicket, this is happening and this is not happening, so don't try it. So like you were mentioning before, giving your information and a positive information is so critical. Sharing is caring is the word. In his case, he literally practiced it. For me, these are the small things will actually bring a lot of change in our lifestyles. And considering these COVID scenarios, the earthquakes, the cyclones, all these things, what is hampering? Incidentally, even the Sushant Singh Rajput's unfortunate suicide. What is happening is we start thinking negatively. We start becoming negative. What is it that required? All of us who are part of this have always got that few positives, which we choose to put that into back burner because our negative thought always comes. Mere saath aisa hota toh. I have experienced something like that. And that's when we require Dr. Shetty, Mugda, to guide us in that, yes, negative thoughts will always be there. And that's when sport gives us an edge to forget about the negative and think about the positive. And for me, I have learned one small last incident I will share. It's a slightly elaborative one. Sachin Tendulkar, we all know, is a God gift. He can do anything and everything what cricket can ask for. But it's a public domain and that's why I'm sharing it. It's all available on a public domain and he has quoted, so has Rahul Dravid. In a Sydney test match, he was struggling with his tennis elbow. And he was getting out caught behind because he could not grip the ball with his top hand. and he was getting out in slips in caught behind. The day before the match in the nets, he said that to Rahul Dravid, "Rahul, I'm not going to play a cover drive tomorrow." Saying is one thing. He actually said that day before the match that I'm not going to be playing a cover drive tomorrow when I go to bat. He went on and did that. Not a single cover drive he played, and he got 240 plus runs. So the control over mind of not doing and not getting tempted to do is a brilliant example he gave as a case study to me personally to learn, purely because, you know, it's about controlling your controllables. He controlled that he doesn't want to do that, and he went on and did not do it, is a brilliant execution of what he thought and what he went on to do. For me, this is what cricket gave me as a learning. And I, like you said, I'm still a student, and I like to learn and observe and understand all the legends who share their incidents. Because this, if you start applying it to your day-to-day practice, you know, sky is the limit for you.
Mr. Nilesh, the point, as you hammered that Mr. Kumble used to guide, I was just correlating that invariably I talk in the offices that they say I is illness and V is wellness. So as long as we are not working together, so wellness will not be there. The only difference between I and V is that it changes the entire perspective of the time, thought process. I will ask Nilesh to pose a question to Mugdha, so that what is her take, because it's a different platform. I'm at least enjoying the entire session.
So I have one question to Mugdha and to Dr. Shetty also in different contexts. You know, a lot of time we sports people face challenges of handling pressure, and the word is loosely used in a psychiatric term and in the psychology term. How do you help people deal with handling pressure? You know, overcoming anxiety, you know, anticipation, all these norms in a sporting environment are day-to-day life. But to compare that into a non-sporting environment and then give sport analogy and perspective to overcome that. How do you deal with that, and how do you help overcome these things?
Yeah, Mugdha first.
Okay. Yeah. So I think I would like to just relate this to, again, sports, because I am, as I said, 24/7, I am with sports people and I have a sporting background myself. So first of all, yes, because I myself, giving an example about me, I was an extremely anxious person. Whenever I was a swimmer myself, so standing on the blocks, I literally used to shiver. And that was just because of pressure, because if you would have seen me in practice sessions, my coach used to say, you are completely a different person when I watch you in the competitions. And that kind of a changed personality, it could be like a split personality that he used to say. And that's only because of the kind of pressure that I used to go ahead with. Now, being again, as I said, on the other side of the table, we definitely need to understand where is this pressure coming from. And that's what I initially do with my, because sports people who are approaching me, one of the main reasons is because they're not able to handle pressure and they're getting too anxious. And because of that, they're not really achieving or reaching their own potential. So first and foremost, being a sports psychologist, for me, I definitely understand that understanding where that pressure is coming from is the most important point. Is it an internal pressure? Is it internal expectations? Is it the pressure which is coming from external sources, be it your coach, be it your parents? And once we identify the root cause, as psychologists, we tend to work in a better manner. I'll again give you an example, my own example. When I was just 11 years old and I went into my first ever national, and I again had just last event to win to get a national championship, and I was into the finals where I had already broken the record of the nationals in the heats itself. And that's the time, just 10 minutes before my finals, there were two girls who approached me and they said, you know, this is the kind of timing that you've clocked in the heats and you've broken the record. That's really good. But you know, what do we clock? I mean, this is what in the heats, we just swam very slow. Let's look in the finals. We are definitely going to defeat you. And that's where I immediately came under pressure. And my confidence level was completely broken at that moment. But fortunately, my coach was standing behind me. And I think that is where, if there are any coaches maybe, or even parents, that's where I feel, you know, the message that should come from the external sources, especially your coaches. That's where he actually helped me. And he said, whatever, even if you come last, I will not regret, or I will not scold you being a coach, because I know the efforts that you have put in up till now. So forget about the results, whether you're coming first or last. Just concentrate on the process that you need to do just to complete a 50 meter race. And luckily, I broke the record. I came first. So this is where every time I related to the pressure, where did that pressure suddenly came from? Where 10 minutes before I was a confident swimmer going for the finals, and just 10 minutes before that, my confidence was broken. And that's just because the external sources brought pressure onto me. So, yes, Nilay, so answering your question, my duty as a sports psychologist, I always believe and I'm always curious to know where the pressure is coming from, rather than just telling my athletes, just relax, never mind, just be tension free and just approach your race.
I think what you have done is you have answered two of the questions which are coming here.
Okay.
Sujit Patak and Arshadan Bardgujar. Sorry, I'm not wearing my specs. So,
okay.
If I have not read it,
I can read the questions. Sujit Patak says lawyers are facing stress related issues. Any change in the mindset or mental exercise to reduce the stress level? I understand the stress will be there in the legal profession. How to cope up?
I need to answer that that earlier question. Three things which we also ask the people is, as you all said, and actually Nilesh has answered that, mindfulness breaks pressure. And mindfulness does not start by big practice. First is, don't watch TV while eating your food. Start by that. And start with food. I see the food, I touch the food, I smell the food, I taste the food, and I'm completely mindful of it. And simple acts of mindfulness. Listening to people who are speaking to you completely with all six senses, not five, six. Six is the emotion. So first is mindfulness. The second most important thing is self-talk. Khud ki boli, khud ko aap kya kehte ho?
Yes.
I have done my well. I have practiced under Nilesh Kulkarni or Mukta. I have cracked a lot of things around me, and I know that I am good. And talking to yourself rewrites or overwrites a program in your own mind. And external pressures that time are not able to penetrate you. They are filtered. And that, I think, is very important. Third is feedback. Externally, the coach sees you. You are succumbed to pressure. The coach comes and says, see, your body did this. Because pressure has four components. Thoughts, mera lag jayega. That's a ka. English mat anuvad hai kare Nilesh.
Band bajegi. Band bajegi.
band hai. Phir agla to Hindi word hai.
I know, I'm just using a Hindi noun.
Yeah. So, self-talk and feedback. Feedback is important. And the fourth most important thing is that are you aware of the sensations which are happening in your body? If you revert the sensations, your pressure will go down. And visualization, as Mukta would know.
Yeah. Yes.
Before the event, visualize your victory. Visualize the six which you have hit to marshal, or visualize something you have done. I still remember Gavaskar's innings in Bombay. When India lost that test, when he hit 82 in the evening, if you remember, without a helmet.
Yeah.
Without a helmet. And visualize the entire experience, the successful experience in slow motion, and let it penetrate your unconscious. So these are the other tools which you can help to understand, to break the pressure. Thank you for asking me. I'm so fortunate to be with you, Nilesh. I should read your name in the newspaper.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So, at least you two have been interacting. Out of three, two had a common block. Try to understand my excitement that three not known, but through a social platform, staying connected. And so there was no overlapping, but as they say, that all rooms are built on four walls. So I feel that I'm one of the pillar to make the room complete for the thought process.
There's a question from Radhika Kulkarni also.
So first I will read. So Sujit Patel's question has not been answered.
Mugda.
Yes, sir.
Radhika.
Yes, yes. I have. Okay, I'll have to just wear my specs to ask, read the question.
No, I will read the question.
Yeah, we'll please. Yeah.
What we will unmute Radhika. Radhika can ask the question directly. Radhika, we have unmuted you. You can ask the question directly. The participants who want to get unmuted, they can post it in the chat box. Radhika.
Yes, very good evening.
First of all, while we are talking of this thing, you will have to show the video to so that at least we say that after 1 hour that there is a confidence exploding within the mind. Because that would be one of the key.
I'm very sorry. My device is not supporting video right now. So I'm sorry. You will just have to hear me talk.
Yeah, Radhika. Yes, go ahead.
Yes, it's very exciting for me to be on this platform because two of my biggest mentors, Mugda Ma'am and Dr. Shetty, are here. But I also want to share this experience because my brother is an international chess player.
I'm slightly louder.
Is this better?
Yeah.
So another interesting thing is that my brother plays chess internationally, and I had introduced him to Mugda ma'am. So he was training under her also for quite some time. So very interestingly, what we discovered through his sessions with Mugda ma'am is that although being, you know, practicing a lot, like how all of you are talking about building ambition, getting into a lot of practice and working very mindfully towards the game. He used to do all of that. But, he met success very late. So he used to be often very dejected, very demotivated. And, you know, most of our childhood talks used to be like, oh, I don't want to do this. He used to call me Akka. We speak Kannada at home. So, you know, he used to be very dejected. Oh, I don't want to play this tournament. I don't want to do this. I don't think I'll do well. So I've spent a lot of time, you know, kind of trying to motivate him, help him. So ideally, my question here is that, okay, some who do well, who do really well, all right, they push through. But then what about this pack who, you know, who need that kind of motivation and guidance? What kind of how ma'am was talking about pressure, what kind of pressure that sport also negatively play, which often puts their passion down, or, you know, makes them so dejected that they don't want to continue. We have a lot of lost talent also that we can see in most places. What would you want to say about that?
Who is this question directed to?
Anybody. I mean, nothing like that. Anybody. Yeah.
Dr. Shetty can answer this question.
No, I think I would like, because he watches, he sees a lot of people in his own sport going up and down, and I would add if necessary. Yeah, Dilesh.
Okay, I will just add a couple of points. You know, see, what sport teaches you is to handle failure. And a person is actually not coming up to that. Like Mugda mentioned, there are a lot of layers of thoughts which actually leads to that thought process of him or her not being able to cross the line. I will tell you from my personal experience, I will relate that. You know, coming from Dombivli, I never experienced playing in front of the crowd. You stop thinking. How do you get it back on track? The focusing part, the exercises. There are a lot of tools which are available for you to get your concentration going. And Dr. Shetty and Mugda are equipped to share that. But what I practice, I'm sharing and narrating that. Get him to do all these practices. You will be dejected. You will be, you know, pulled down. It's sport, end of the day. One person wins, one person loses. And you have to first start accepting that. How consistently you become a winner is a process. It has to start by you start believing that you can achieve. And you relate that to any normal day-to-day life, it applies in the same context. What sport gives you is the preparatory work. How well you prepare for those moments. How well you train yourself for those moments helps you overcome that anxiety. Helps you overcome handling pressure. To understand that, you know, there are gods have created legends and geniuses, and there are average sports people. The good part is you can talk about Usain Bolt. He's a genius. Mm-hmm. People who believe in being are genius because they knew they're up against the wall who beat his time, they actually believe that they can beat. For me, they are the champions. And he should start referring to those. And if he starts focusing on his aspiration, should be beating Anand. For me, that should be the goal. What he's doing, the preparation starts. Half the battle is of handling pressure and the negativity and the dejection and demotivation. He will start overcoming that.
Actually, I agree with you. But also, I deal with a lot of actors who, because in films, you have 50 roles and you have 1 lakh aspirants. I mean, beyond that. And everybody will not get a role. They go for auditions 100 times. And I have actually helped actors leave acting and go to some other profession because they can't hang on for a long time. I mean, there's the example of Nawazuddin is very rare after 14 years. But what is very important there is even if you have not become a champion, the learnings across this last 5 years is going to help you across your life and build your life. But if you stand dejected and sad and ashamed, you block all the learning. There is no event which has not taught you. So that is the crucial difference for every person. I remember an actress who wanted to make it big. She had everything, but she failed. So I had to sit down with her and help her ask, what did you learn in all this? She said, I really became very strong. I'm very resilient. I can work with people. I can work with teams. I can sit and hear shit, but I can think through and respond to it. So any experience in any field which you may have lost, which you may have gained, and everybody will not become number one. Neil Armstrong was the only person who landed the moon first. We don't remember somebody who landed after him. We don't remember any names anymore. But I think every experience, every struggle, be aware of your learning. That gets transferred across life in your other professions, in rearing your children, in rearing your family, and in helping the community. I think that is something which is very important.
Yeah, one of the things which I would like to add here, as Radhika has said, that you know we have so many lost talents, and one of the biggest reasons I suppose for that is the reason why our sports people or why the parents are putting their kids into sport. Because I'll give you one or two examples where I had one father bringing his son along, and the son was playing cricket. And usually the first session which we have is an intake session, a detailed history session. And by, the father said that I want to make my son a Sachin Tendulkar. Okay, now look at the pressure that the child is actually going through. That one sentence, and we as psychologists, I think we are now trained enough to hold on to all these, you know, those one-liners also give us a lot of meaning to the session.
So in life, Mukda, in the film, we only remember the one line. We don't remember the
fact. exactly. So out of that 1 hour session, we remember that one line, and that's where the actual problem lied, because the cricketer, the player, was not reaching up to his potential because the pressure from the home front. Okay, because the father wanted him to play like Sachin Tendulkar and not like what he or she was at that moment. That's one. Secondly, why we have lost talent? Because I usually write from MCA. I don't know whether Nilesh also knows. I take sessions for our players, especially for under 19 and 23, because they cannot see anything beyond cricket. And that's the biggest problem with all our cricketers, because as we always say that, you know, there are 11 lakh cricketers practicing daily out there, but there are only 11 getting into the team. So what happens to the rest of them? So please prepare for plan B. And that would be another reason where you would reduce the pressure. You will start enjoying the game. Once you start enjoying the game, obviously your performance is going to go up.
Completely.
And that's the key to the whole thing of mental toughness. I think Nilesh wanted to add something.
Yeah. No. I just wanted him to unmute me because I suddenly went on a mute for no reason.
That's what I saw. I saw where is Mr. Nilesh, then I saw that he has muted himself.
Okay.
Mr. Nilesh, your insights.
See, like I always say, I believe one, and I have actually practiced that. If you know your strengths, that's your asset. If you realize that strength, that's what it is. And that personally, I believe. which every single person needs to think and practice, even at a workplace or even a sporting environment. Because, you know, you will always feel rejections. You will always feel dejections. You'll always find a superior who's, you know, probably more smart, would want to bring you down. It's the ability that you have within you, whether it's in the courtroom, in your day-to-day life, or into sporting environment. How you learn to apply that is the key for your success, rather than, you know, you will always find n number of references for you to learn from. You'll always get, and I always relate that from a sports perspective.
Mr. Nilesh?
Wi-Fi is hanged.
Probably.
Yeah.
That is one of the key to be taken, that sometimes the way it does, what Mukta ma'am said, that you have to be always be ready with the plan B. So either you have to have a Wi-Fi or another connection. I will ask him to connect again. Meanwhile, we are unmuting Bhavna Khemani. She wants a question to be posed directly to Dr. Shetty.
Yeah,
so meanwhile, one is asked, what is mindfulness?
Nilesh is back. I think he should answer that question.
Nilesh is back.
He's
muted. We are unmuting him.
And
we are unmuting him.
Yeah. Bola sir, Nilesh. Dada, bola.
I think it's raining in Mumbai, so even the internet is giving me a trouble.
Yeah. So, no, we lost you in between.
I know. So I'm just saying that the problem lies in taking that decision. A lot of people ask the question about the anxiety, handling pressure situations, handling difficult adversities. I think the key thing is, like Dr. Shetty mentioned, is let's first start accepting that you have made a mistake. Let's first start realizing that, look, this is which is not gone the way I intended it to be. The moment you have that as your acceptance, half the battle is overcome. Then you're thinking about correcting it. Then you're thinking about bettering it. And when you think about that, then you're thinking about the improvement. I think that's where a lot of time you will see a lot of sports personalities. If you get out, you think about not repeating that. If you think about dropping a catch, you think about not making the same mistake. Because if you dwell upon that negativity, you will not think about what's coming better for you to correct it and improve it. For me, that's the biggest takeaway sport can give. And for mindfulness and the improvement and the personality development, these are the two key elements which you can learn to apply. And for me, real-time is sport. And there are two fields which gives us the real-time experiences. One is sport and second is our forces. Unfortunately, forces, people lose our life. In sport, we still get another match, if at all we are lucky. But you still have that chance. It's not a retake. But in your lifetime, in your courtroom, you can still think about correcting it. You have an advantage. Think about that as a positive.
Before we unmute Bhavna, one person has asked Gauravdeep Goyal, what is mindfulness? They said that time and again we have repeated the word of mindfulness. What do you...
बहुत बड़ी बात नहीं है. यदि आपके बच्चे छोटे हैं, तो उनको खाना खाते वक्त तुम अपना आईपैड चालू मत करो. उसको बोलो खाना खाते वक्त खाना खाना चाहिए, आराम से खाना चाहिए, टेस्ट लेके खाना चाहिए. Staying in the present, being in the present. So start very early. Unfortunately, the families of today are very scared of even a simple tantrum. Tantrum is an opportunity to build values. Without tantrum, there are no values. There's no changing behavior. So start young, even your two-year-old child, thoda dhamal kya, to tolerate the dhamal, he comes back to you and again starts eating. And as he enjoys the eating, he's in the moment. As enjoying being with the mother, he's in the moment. Slowly, when he starts focusing, he'll be in the moment. It's in the moment. That can be enhanced by meditation. That can be enhanced by yoga. Vipassana is the hallmark of mindfulness. Aur hamare Bhagwan Buddha jo hai, wo mental health professional the. The two biggest psychiatrists on the earth was Patanjali and Bhagwan Buddha. And the West patented it, broke it into pieces, and they have modules. Vipassana is free of cost. But mindfulness, we go for a class, you're paid. Mindfulness is being completely in the present. Being in the present. When I'm here, I'm with you in the show, completely in the present. So that can be practiced through simple methods. as a challenge, not a big technology. Well, Americans convert every aspect of life into technology, workshop, and a project. But Eastern philosophies use it mindfully, mindfulness, and they have been practicing across time. So I advise every family, even if they don't like yoga or any form of meditation, just sit down without doing anything for 15 minutes, without reason. Just watch your thoughts coming and going, watch your feelings which come and go, watch the sensations that's happening, and let it slowly settle down. And you'll improve the ability to be in the moment. It's a long journey, it's a long process. That's what it is. So, for example, they will start saying in your workshop, take a small grip, usko zaban pe dalo, ghumao. Usko bada technology bana ke aapko wo bechenge. But ultimately kya hai? Ultimately, jo bhi kaam karte ho, puri dhyan, lagan, aur pure zehen ke saath jab aap karte ho, usko kehte hai mindfulness. But abhi in this era, it's era of distraction. You can't do multiple things at a time. In that era, mindfulness has gained more momentum. It also helps your mind and the body to align with each other. It also helps your health to be normal.
Thank you, doctor. We have unmuted Bhavna. Ma'am, you can ask the question directly, and you can ask to whom you have posed that question.
Good evening, sir, Dr. Shetty.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello.
Bhavna, ma'am, I suppose you won't have that same problem of video.
No, video problem is not there. You can hear me, sir?
Yeah.
No, we all want to see you. That's what he's saying.
Oh, okay, sir. So
we say that the self-esteem, that confidence to come across, that's important.
I put on my video, sir.
Yeah.
So actually, I have a granddaughter, 2 years old. I want to know how can we train the child right from small age so that she can face the adversities, like, you know, what the children are going through now, the pressures of studies and other competitions. Like, you know, what are the just one or two tips where, you know, the parents can inculcate in their children right from this age? If you could slightly enlighten me on this aspect, sir.
This is the brightest person to answer this is Mukta.
Mukta, please, ma'am.
Mukta, you're frozen again. Mukta, I think, is frozen.
No,
anyway,
no.
Mukta,
no,
you,
Mukta is fine.
Heard that, you
yeah.
heard that question.
Hello? Yeah, actually, I couldn't. Hello?
How can she?
No, I couldn't hear it clearly. I don't know. Everyone is frozen on my screen.
Mukta, can you hear me now? Can you
hello?
Hear me? Can you hear me?
Hello?
Anyway,
hello, ma'am.
Hello?
I'll answer the question.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yes, now I can. Yes.
Mukta, she is a grand, active grandmother who wants two tips for a 2-year-old grandchild, how to be positive and how to face
hello?
Life. In the future.
Hello, ma'am.
The 2-year-old?
Yes,
how to train her to be positive in
hello?
The difficult world.
Can you hear me?
Yes,
ma'am, you are audible. Mukta, ma'am, you are audible.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello,
ma'am.
I'm sorry, I think there's a network fluctuation. I can't hear.
I'll answer this if
yeah,
she's
yeah.
not around. Okay. Allow the 2-year-old to be.
Hello.
Okay, sir.
Allow the 2-year-old to be. You are a grandmother. You have taken care of children. You now rest and relax. Enjoy your grandmother life and allow the child to be. That's very important. Okay. See that the child is not given too many rules and too many guidelines. Allow the child to laugh, cry, play, and be himself or herself. And what is very important is don't make him street smart. Huh? We all want to make our kids street smart. Taki is katin duniya mein wo pure zindagi ki takleefon ko face karke aage jayega. Make him compassionate. The world will make him street smart. If you can teach compassion, if you can teach the child to live with others and cohabitate, if you can help the child to understand what is just and what is not just, if you can help the child eat well, sleep well, and play and laugh loudly, you have made it. No need to do anything more મિસિસ કેમાની કશું કરવાનું ગરજ નથી બેન, એટલા જ કરજો તમે, બહુ ફાઇન થશે તમારા ગ્રેન્ડ ચાઇલ્ડ.
The way Dr. Shetty, you have given the inputs, and I was reading on your T-shirt, I'm just reminding that actually when it was discovered, it said Eureka, and that's the key what we have got found today.
But I'm really happy that she's a very aware grandmother, and she has mental health awareness as of now at this point in life. She would not want to make the same mistake which she has made with the son, which is also the thought behind the question.
Because they say that everybody likes interest more than the principal. So that is why on the grandchildren one tries to pull up. Jai Gandhi, in a life of an employee, many times a situation arises where he is expecting more salary than what he gets. This demotivates the employee. How to stay on course in the right way?
Mukta, Nilesh.
I mean, I can answer if Mukta, you want to answer that?
Yeah, Nilesh, please. No, please go ahead.
I get this question even from my students, so I'm used to handling that. You know, there are times where
that's the reason you are a best person to answer this.
No, I get a lot of my students come to me and tell me that, you know, they believe that they can manage Virat Kohli. So I ask them a question: does Virat Kohli believe that he trusts in you to actually manage that part? Is the answer you need to find first. In terms of if you believe and if you equip yourself to be that ready of increase of salary, promotion, you know, change of jobs, multiple way. If you believe that you justify the expectations of a company or a boss, half of the things will be ironed out there, because it's not about you are talking and they are listening. It's about them seeing it. And there's a beautiful story I learned when I was playing cricket by Sunil Gavaskar sir, and I'll narrate it here. When I was dejected and frustrated, I got 5 wickets against Australian visiting team and I was dropped from the Indian team. So it was at CCI where Australian team and Mumbai team, if all you remember, Sachin Tendulkar got his first 200 in that match. And after the match got over, I was sitting, there was a party arranged. I was sitting in a corner and very obvious, Gavaskar sir saw me sitting quietly. So he called me, Nilesh, come here. I said, what happened? I said, sir, just feeling bad. I got 5 wickets against Australian team and I was part of the Indian team and I still got dropped from the Indian team. He said, do one thing. Knock the door with your performance. Knock it once. If they can't hear it, knock it louder with your performance. Make sure you knock it louder. In spite of your louder performance, if they can't hear it, third time, make sure you break the door. So even if they can't hear it, they bloody well have to see it. So that's the mantra you should be following. That if you believe in your own ability by your performances, even if your boss or superior boss or the higher boss, someone will always notice it. Even if you think that your immediate boss has missed out, your performance will speak volume for yourself. So you don't need to talk about it. Eventually, you will get rewarded.
Mukta ma'am, your insights, because the way that when we had asked you to come on the platform, I said I had read Shreyas Iyer saying that the entire thought process changed after he was associated with you. The insights, how do you build that confidence? How that person comes to that level? Just on that. Mukta ma'am is there?
I think she's facing some challenge.
Because
she's trying to break the door.
heavy rains in Bombay.
Dr. Shetty, I would like, because you have done with a lot of actors.
I think what they said, sir, it's like this. Nobody can stop the sun from shining. थोड़े बादल आएंगे, झक मार के तुम इम्प्रूव करोगे तो किसी का माई बाप आपको रोक नहीं सकते. There is no कोटरी or no group can stop any sun from shining. Ye seedhi baat hai, sir. You focus on your performance. Maybe you're not visible on day one, but it's impossible for the world not to see you. Your biggest skeptics, your biggest critics will become your lobbyists. And that's how it is. I think I echo the same answer which sir gave.
No, sir, the fact, that's one of the keys, but since I was reading that large number, you have been treating a lot of actors, and as you said, that you, just like cricket, 11 lakh people applying, even for an IIT or medical, you have 500, 600. But in sports, there are only 11 players ultimately making it. So it's more tough. So this depression part would definitely
actors,
come.
Among actors, sir, all those who have succeeded have certain qualities. One is they persevere and persevere. They are not ordinary, sir. They continue persevering. They continuously reinvent themselves all the time. They take feedback from everybody and change themselves. They improvise. And all those who have done extreme, let's look at this difference. I should not say this. I will not talk about the difference of cricketers today or yesterday, but day before yesterday, Brijesh Patel, Mr. Kulkarni.
Yeah.
Our Brijesh Patel in Karnataka. He could hit sixers in the first class matches, but he could not manage his test matches. Then you have Sandeep Patil, was extremely talented. But there was difference between Vishwanath and Gavaskar. There was difference between Sachin Tendulkar and Kambli. And the difference is their ability to work on themselves continuously. They did not rely on raw talent all the time. And that is the difference between all great actors and others. And all those who blame. See, in life you can be a blamer or you can be a bloomer.
True. Absolutely.
Simple.
Absolutely. Simple.
And if you become a... See, sir, 45 ke umar hota hai, sab log apne ghar mein baithte hain. Zindagi mein sab politics hai. Mujhe, I met one man long ago, mujhe Raja Ramana se bhi jada marks mila tha in physics. Aur wo aage gaya, are bewakoof, Raja Ramana kidhar hai, tu kidhar ho yaar. Ye jo 45 ka jo cynicism hai na, sab jagah politics hai. If you break it at the age of 25, you will grow. Otherwise, you go down. Blamers or bloomers. I mean, that is the word you need to chew in your mind all the time. For all professions. For every profession.
Saloni Gautam has posed a question which will go for all. They say that in a profession, you are required to be very socially active. For that matter, any sports or this thing. But if you are an introvert, a personality, how to change that mind perspective?
Is it true? Have you to be active so socially? I do not know. The great CEOs of the country are very shy and introverted. A lot of great CEOs are very shy. Yeah. They're very I'll share with you an example of from the book Emotional Intelligence. In that book, there's an experiment which was conducted in a classroom.
I suppose Mugda ma'am has joined.
You're listening to this in a classroom. They were asked kids to pair two kids based on the relationship the kids would have. The most shyest kid could pair the groups properly. And they said, this is the girl who will become a CEO. CEO is not about being extroverted, gregarious. And by the way, extroverted people, they don't share their feelings. Huh? They may look extroverted, but the issue is that that introvertedness is a trait which they can have. They have skills enough. They have skills enough to work within their limitations. There is no need to be socially active and be seen with a glass of wine in all parties. I know great MDs who run companies which are global. They are not seen in the media at all.
Yeah, I think one of the points that I would like to make, even Dr. Shetty would agree, is being introvert, being shy. These are all personality traits, and at times we are born with these personality traits. So rather than getting into changing the personality, which is going to be utmost difficult thing, I generally what I work with my athletes is accept the kind of personality that you have and manage it, and let's work towards it. So rather than making a shift from introvert to extrovert, which is going to be a very, very difficult task, except that you are an introverted person, and what else can you do? So when I'm talking from sports perspective, it doesn't need you to be an extrovert person. I'm an introvert. So it doesn't really make any difference whether you are an introvert or an extrovert when it comes to performing at a competition or a tournament. So it really doesn't matter what kind of a personality you have. But yes, it's very important that you express your feelings to somebody rather than keeping those feelings bottled up inside you. And that's where I see last 20 years of my journey being a sports psychologist. I'm seeing so many athletes coming and opening up to me because they know they cannot turn out to their parents or even the coaches. So they need to have somebody whom they can share certain things. So what we call it as catharsis. So just open up to somebody, and that itself is a therapy. So vent out your emotions, vent out your feelings, and that is where the therapy actually starts working out for them. And they feel so relieved when they are there on the ground.
And yeah. one difference is, just because you have to make a difference between introvertedness and anxiety. Anxious yes. people are essentially not introverted. Introverted people may not be anxious at all.
Right, right.
Can I just add one more thing in from a sporting context? Your performance is your biggest tool, whether you are an introvert or an extrovert. And it will always stand out and it will be visible. So if you believe in your own ability and your performance, being introvert or extrovert does not matter.
Does not matter.
End of the day, your performance matters.
Of course.
So after hearing all three, one point is continuously coming that they say there are three P's of life to succeed. That is persistence, performance, and perseverance. So that is required. I was when somehow Mukta ma'am couldn't answer that question. The way that I had read that Shreyas Iyer says that he's lot of he owes to him, and even on your website he says. So what is? Let's assume everyone out here is a Shreyas Iyer. They have that point that how to come up better. What is the mantra you would like to give to everyone on this platform? How to develop that sense of confidence to do better? Then I will ask both of them also on this aspect.
Yeah, one of the things, as you rightly said, especially when we look at sport, the first thing that comes to our mind is confidence. But I always say as sports psychologist that building self-confidence is not like taking a medicine pill and then your confidence grows. It actually builds into your everyday training practice. And that's where I would suggest everybody, those who are there on this platform, is concentrating and focusing on the process, on the things that you're putting into your everyday practice is what is the key to building up to your self-confidence. So stick to your process, stick to the routines that you're doing every day. And that's where it is going to take you to your ultimate potential, to your building up onto your performance. And that's where, you know, one of the tips that I've been giving even Shreyas and the other elite athletes as well is your process. So concentrate on the process. I remember one of the books that I was reading about Rafa Nadal, and he had mentioned in his book when he was competing at a Wimbledon against Federer, and he had broken his finger. He had actually fractured his finger just before the finals of Wimbledon, and that was a great chance for him to win the Wimbledon against the great legend that's Federer. And he was into grueling pain just before the finals. But the moment the finals started, he actually forgot about that pain. He actually forgot about the kind of grueling pain that he was going through. And for 5 hours, the way he has fought in at that moment, and that actually helped him to win the Wimbledon finals against Federer. And that's where I call it as process, which he has mentioned in the book. At that moment, if I would have actually focused on the pain, I would have definitely lost the finals. So that's where I talk about the process. Concentrate on the feelings. Concentrate on your breathing process. Concentrate on your basics. These are certain things which will help you to remain in the present and focus on the process that's important for your game.
Thank you, ma'am. Point well taken. I am also reminded that they said, somebody asked Shah Rukh Khan, what is the key to success mantra? He says, focus on the aim. The peripherals like car, koti, servants, they are automatically which flow out of them. So just focus on the main goal, and then these are the peripherals which automatically flow. Mr. Nilesh, what would be your, let's assume you are in your institute, you had an open class and you had to tell your students, what is your key that the student should learn from on this platform?
I think one of the key takeaways I would like to park for everyone is every problem has a solution. We just have to look at it differently. We start discussing about problems more than thinking about the finding a solution. I think one of the key thing which I always believe that we discuss a lot about the problems without little realizing that we do not focus on trying to find a solution for problem. Acceptance is one of the key things for you to start thinking about solving a problem. A lot of times we face this challenge when you're on the field. Now I'm in my institute. A lot of times we realize, "Arey, ye to nahi ho sakta, impossible." But why is it impossible? There must be some point which can give you solution to overcome that. Have you thought about it? Have you given a different perspective? Because you will, if there are problems created or problems existed, there is always a solution around the corner. We just need to have a different perspective, different analogy, different analysis to think about addressing that problem. You will 9.9 out of 10 times you will find a solution to this. There's always 1% which is controlled by God, but the rest of the things are controlled by humans. And if you don't think in that direction, you'll always be challenged yourself. And that's when the negativity starts. That's when the challenging situation starts. That's when you think that, oh, I'm the only one who's not getting it. The rest of the gang is getting it. They're benefiting it. So this is where we start thinking differently. And I always believe that is one key thing. We should always think about, try to solve a problem rather than discuss a problem. Yes, discussing is important, but approach the problem with ability to solve it, which apply to sport, which apply to day-to-day life. If you think about it, you'll always overcome that. And do not fear about failure, because failure is part of your life. If you think about failure and remain in failure aspects, you will never think about overcoming that.
Before we will ask Dr. Shetty, that question which Mr. Nilesh had read, somehow in the flow, we didn't even realize that question was never answered. Arshdan Gujar, anxiety problem is becoming a global pandemic. Sir, I request you to please advise us on the same as to reduce it. Madam, your advice too will be helpful. So he wants a double whammy.
I'm supposed to answer it?
Yeah. I think sir would be better, because if he's talking about anxiety, it would be better if sir answers. Yeah.
No, but he says then double whammy. First him, and then he says cherry on the top of the cake.
You start, Mukta. I'll end it here.
Yeah, basically. When he's talking about anxiety, I would say it's a little a next step towards fear. I would say a next step after, beyond fear.
Because of the rains problem, there is. Dr. Harish, you can take up then, ma'am.
Dekho bhai.
So,
go ahead. Bukta, go ahead.
Am I audible? Because just the screen froze. Yeah. So one of the things is identify where the anxiety is coming from, and then identifying the solution for the anxiety related issues would definitely be better. So I'm sure Dr. Shetty would be able to speak a lot better than on this.
I would like to add to that. I think she's perfectly right in the brilliant way of putting it. Please look at our Eastern practices. Americans are making big money through Eastern practice. Yoga abhyas brings down anxiety. It calms down your sympathetic nervous system and brings a balance between sympathetic and parasympathetic. It helps the mind to sing with the body. It does not make it play a jugalbandi. When there's jugalbandi, mind and the body gets destroyed. So that is number one. Number two is behind your anxiety is a story, and behind that story there are many stories. A lot of anxiety in adulthood starts from childhood. So there are a lot of practices by which you can bring down the anxiety. Please, anxiety travels much faster than the influenza virus or the coronavirus. So if you have an environment which is very anxious in the house, chalne ke waqt idhar bhi dekho, udhar bhi dekho, na to gaadi tumko thok degi. You know, some parents have this, seedha dekho, idhar bhi mat dekho, udhar bhi mat dekho, accident ho sakta hai. So when you have a lot of anxious sentences, hum tumko itna coaching diya, tumne kya kiya? They might say it out of frustration once, but that sits in the head. That is number two. Number three is anxiety is an artifact of the globalized world, because they're all looking around our shoulder. Apun general manager banega, fir vice president banega. Sab maya hai, boss. Maya, when you think about your journey on this earth, and you want to enjoy this journey well, anxiety goes down. When you are in your scoot, I had a bike when I was a doctor. I come from very ordinary background, Mr. Nilesh. And I had to go and park this bike at a Hinduja hospital because I had to go and see a patient. So that the watchman said, idhar se hatao gaadi. To car ke liye hai. Maine kaha, meri gaadi, meri hai. I respect my vehicle. Because it's important to respect whatever you have in life.
Yeah.
I said, I have to park here and I'm a doctor. I have to visit at this for doctors. And I stood, I was not ashamed that I was on a bike. And that brings down anxiety. So, my dear friends, all your viewers, respect what you have around you. Your spouse, your table, your kursi, your banana. If you can't afford the aam, perfectly all right. Anxiety goes. But when you think tu banana khate, wo aam khate, anxiety badhta hai. So, it's so important to accept, respect, and love what Allah has given you. I think is the most beautiful thing for bringing down anxiety. And I completely agree with Mukta when he says that for players, source of anxiety has to be addressed.
So, Varsha Vasave, sir, I am a student and having been in the hostel since I was 7 years old. And the purpose of asking my question is, since I belong to a tribal community, people often judge me because I'm a villager and manage them to answer back. But inside I feel empty. So what is that thing which makes me empty though I answer them back? I feel low when I'm alone.
Well, tribal communities are indigenous communities. They have a lot of wealth which others don't have. Realize that first. Research your tribe. Research all the practices and the folk songs and all the other things which you have. Well, I have worked with tribals at Danu for a short time. I have seen the Pase Parvis in Maharashtra. As a president of My Home India, we have a lot of tribes in the Northeast. They are richer than all the other folks around you. Discover that first. Confidence will come. Tell the world what is the most fascinating thing about your tribe across time.
Ramas.
Tell them that most of the tribal kids which I have seen in Jamshedpur, I've been to schools in Jamshedpur, they are very calm because they are close to nature. All the guys who live in concrete are not close to nature. They are restless in the class. They make a lot of noise. Go to the school, tribal school. They are climbing trees. The mind is fertile. If they get in the positive, they do much better than everybody else. So discover your ancestry. Be proud of your ancestry. Share the good things about your tribe with others. They'll be fascinated and you'll feel that you are one. And what is also very important is your belief in yourself, your acceptance of yourself. And when you open your shoulder and look up and share, the world will change around you. There's no need for you to become like them. Remember that, okay? I always tell boys and girls as I meet them in my workshop, you can never be Aishwarya Rai, but Aishwarya Rai can never be you. And that I think is extremely important for him. You may have been in the college and you may get other facilities which others don't have. You deserve that. It's not a charity for you. You deserve that for being in that state. And it's just a mechanism of bringing the society on the same ground so that they can compete equally. So be proud of your tribe and learn more about your tribe. When you learn English, don't forget your tribe and share those insights to everybody around. You are an indigenous community, which is very rare across the world. In America, they destroyed the indigenous community. In Australia, the Aboriginals were destroyed. Indians, they are still, India, they are still preserved. And that I think is very important.
I will take a question from the Facebook. Vibha Shukla, what to do when most of the time a person becomes a culprit of every worst situation that occurs? Is it possible that only a person is at fault every time, or is it because the person straightforward said the actually things without being sugar-coated Gandhis? What to do to modify the behavior or handle these situations in a peaceful manner? Hello.
Bada bada question and aap batao, Mr. Kulkarni will answer both bada question.
Mr. Kulkarni can handle because the players are always ready to gear up at a speed, ball coming at a speed of 150 kilometers also. So their time reactions would always be faster.
No, you are, the best part about sports people is you are preparing for unknown. And in a sporting environment, if you are preparing, your planning is in for unknown, you are better equipped to handle multiple situations. I think the simplest thing is to do simple thing right. And a lot of time we make a mistake of doing simple thing right. We start thinking about the big goals and the big achievements, but doing the simple thing. And in sport, I always say, and we always follow, that, you know, put in that 1% extra, that 1% makes a huge difference. Are you good in putting that extra effort? Is in your hand, it's up to you. If you believe in that, you will definitely get the results in your way.
Absolutely.
The session, at least, I am finding it very interesting. As Mr. Shetty was saying that he was tight pressed. We can continue with the session because at least
I just would like to add one thing.
Ma'am, your video.
Said rightly.
Ma'am, your video.
Yeah, okay, now आवाज आती है.
Yeah.
बोले. Yes, Mukta.
Ma'am, you can close the video. Otherwise, probably there's a difference of the bandwidth. Yes.
Yeah, it's on from my side.
Mukta, close your video so your audio will be better output.
Yes, you can see me.
Suggesting close your video because of the internet challenge and you'll have a better output on your
audio. Yeah, I just wanted to add one thing what Nilesh has said, that usually hello?
Yes, ma'am, it's audible.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, hello. I've closed the video.
I've closed the video.
Yeah, ma'am, it's audible. We are able to hear you.
Yeah, you can hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. No, I just wanted to.
I think she's finding it difficult on the net connection.
It's raining. It's pouring here.
It's pouring down.
How's Anna Nilesh?
Oh, it's pouring down.
So I think this time it is more because of happiness that people are actually getting the issues settled down. The rain is trying to settle down the dust, which is actually in the minds because of the inputs from all three of you. The insights. Anna. As they say, impossible, it's a common word. They say impossible would mean I am possible. And then they say improve would mean I am to prove. And the proof that Mr. Kulkarni said, that the proof has to be by performance only. One question is from Farhanas. I faced a lot of suppressions and subjugations, kind of very tortured childhood, because of which I still remain underconfident and nervous. Can I ever overcome this past that haunts me even today, facing anxiety? What is the way forward?
Audit your life with the help of a counselor. Meet a mirror who will help you to reflect and repair. Life is full of stories. Problems are stories going wrong. Counseling is repair of the story.
Nileji, what is your call then? What take will you give to the society as we initially started off? Meanwhile, I will try to connect with Mukta ma'am.
I just lost your question.
So I said that it's again, as we say in time and again, that in cricket also, as you said, it's sometimes. Hello, is it audible? Nileji, is it audible? Large number of, though we have been a cricket buff, you had been on the other side, that you have been always playing cricket and then putting the things forward. Sometimes, normally, in at least in cricket, as you rightly said, that around 11 lakhs people trying to perform for a cricket and 11 make it. But sometimes, as Mr. Shetty said, Rajesh Patel was performing in domestic. Large number of players, Raman Lamba was one of the players who have actually performed. You could only feel that they could only perform, they could never perish. But as life has its own vagaries and life has its own challenges, what do you believe that once an opportunity given, just you have followed more Margun Attapattu, could you just give that illustration that we were discussing in the morning, that he makes it after 5 years, two ducks, then duck and zero. You remember that of Margun Attapattu, of Sri Lankan captain?
Marwan is a very good friend.
Yeah. So if you remember him, that once he came for the first time, he makes two double ducks. Then he's dropped for a good 21 months. He comes back, makes 0 and 1. Then again dropped, comes after 17 months, again double duck. Then he comes after 3 years. Then he performs century. Then in 5,000 runs, 16 centuries and 6 double centuries. One way, I was reading that article, it said one way for Attapattu was to drop that 6 years is a very task, but he continued to persist with that and ultimately performed. So,
Harsha explained the story beautifully. Harsha Bogle's favorite story. Harsha Bogle says it all the time.
Yes, sir. So, it is only we are learning nuances from you, and I was saying learning would also not be there. I would like that you to put across. And since you are a psychiatrist also, how to overcome all this and to make big in the real perspective, not to be getting depressed.
No, I think a big jo hai na, ye maya hai. You try and compete with yourself all the time, audit your life all the time, karte raho, par ye big or small mein ye pressure mein lag jaati hai zindagi. Aaj ka match mein tumne inhone kaha for first wicket liya, that is the memorable wicket for Milesh. He will never forget it in his life. He'll share it with his family. His family will share it with their children. So Indians, as they were, they should also learn to appreciate themselves, because Indians do not appreciate each other so easily. Kintu, parantu, agar, magar, both of them. I think let Nilesh only answer that, because he has seen Marwan.
Yes, that's what I'm saying.
Who is his best friend.
The good part is what Marwan did, that he never stopped believing in himself, that he belonged there. And when every time I had a conversation with him, and you know, a lot of people again put him down, but he believed that he had in him to belong at international level, and he can be successful at that level. A lot of times you will get success immediately. There are times you will get success little late, but eventually, if you have, like Dr. Shetty mentioned, perseverance and a patience and the ability and the belief you have for yourself. The moment you believe in your ability and what you can do, you will definitely succeed in life. It may take some time. It may take immediately. It may take slightly longer time. In Marwan's case, it took him longer time to deliver what was expected within himself in front of the stage. Because, you know, he always believed that he could get 100 playing against Australia, playing against India. He believed that he could do that. It took him longer time to deliver that, which is part of your journey. You and me don't control the journey. We control the process. We control the entire thing, what we can control. I think that's the beauty of what we start believing in. He never stopped believing in it. And a lot of questions are coming in that direction. I would like to tell them that, you know, the moment you start doubting yourself, you start have a question whether I'm good at it, that means your downfall, you're starting thinking differently. If you believe that you can win against, if I can compete against the top lawyer in the world, I don't fear, I don't worry about it. But preparation and process should never deviate. That's the most important part during the journey. And
I think that sentence is a $1 billion sentence. The journey is not in our hands. The process is in our hands.
Fantastic. So that's a fantastic way. And the fact Mogda ma'am is also trying to log in and log out. Probably she has just logged in and she has written that she's not been able to hear. I will ask her. We are trying to unmute her. Ma'am, probably you have logged twice because two names, you are being reflected twice in the stream. But you can try to unmute yourself. We are unmuting you.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
We can say it's an inspirational story. Ma'am is actually liking the show. She goes out, comes back, but yeah, with more vigor, the participants are more keen to hear her also. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I think I've lost the initial conversation. So just I think, try to help me out where we were.
That Dr. Harish Shetty is the connecting point.
Because I've lost a...
he was just asking about Marwan Attapattu, who continuously fought for many years, then he shined. And what Mr. Kulkarni said is that his belief never wavered, and he continued believing in yourself.
Correct.
Along with that, he worked hard. If you can add something there.
Yeah. So that's, I think, one of the major characteristics when we talk about mental toughness in sports. So there are two, three things that I would really like to say quickly is obviously your self-confidence or your self-belief, your positivity, and accepting the situation the way it is and concentrating on the things which are under your control. I think these are the four things which not only sports people, but even otherwise outside the sporting background also, if you really implement and look at these four things, I think that's going to be the best thing which can help us in our usual life as well, whether it is your workplace, professional life, personal life. So these are the four things. I think I always say these are four mantras for your life to be not really not stress-free life.
We can since we are touching sex, we have.
I'll just add one small story.
Yes, sir, Nilesh Thai. Dada, bola. Yes,
I'll just add one beautiful story which I read in England early 90s, where Pete Sampras narrated this story. Pete Sampras, legendary tennis player, he wanted to turn major from a junior tennis player. So he requested Yvonne Lendl, the number one player that time, that can I train with you to be competent enough at the highest level? So Yvonne Lendl, after a lot of perseverance, agreed. And he said that, let's start the training, but no questions asked. So the first day of the training was given to him that you decide what you want. And very voluntarily, because he was young, 17-year-old, he said, let's do endurance training. So Yvonne Lendl's girlfriend was sitting in a car and he said, Pete, you have me when you feel tired. And it's about physical as well as mental. So they ran for good kilometers. And at a point where Pete Sampras felt tired, and he said, Yvonne, I think that's it. I'm tired. In his mind, he was thinking that he can drive back to the starting point. But Yvonne Lendl said, no, we have to finish at a starting point. So the tiredness in the mind and the physic part took overcome with the mind sharpness. So he made sure that he allowed him to reach to a point where his body felt tired in the endurance, and he wanted him to finish at a start point.
Right.
And that was the beautiful story which I read, which actually helps you understand how you can train yourself.
True.
Dr. Harish, your inputs, the way the session is going, I will all request you that we can have another session on a different perspective. Today we had only on the mind and personality building.
I think as we come to the close, I've learned a lot from both Mugdha and Nilesh. And what is very important for us to understand that India is at crossroads and it's on the threshold of a great tomorrow. Our children are very aspiring. And between aspirations and victories, we need to build the process which I think Nilesh, that is beautiful. We had no facilities for sports during our time. Ek hockey tha, ek bada ball tha, football tha, ek ground tha. Now I think the Indians will do well. They're aspiring, and the most important thing is the yoke of being ruled has gone. When Imran Khan was bowling, they would say Aurangzeb aa raha hai. Now this Sehwag and Dhoni, they say, who the hell cares? Sehwag ne 200-300 thok dala. Ye Rohit Sharma ne 3-200 and 300. Can you believe 3-200 in one day and 300 in 10, 20? I mean, they are there. We have arrived. And I think it's a great tomorrow. I am sure that these young boys and girls will give us a great tomorrow. We will leap much faster than what we actually believe. India is on the threshold of a great tomorrow. Let's also build the mental software with Eastern philosophies and Western science. That, I think, is the bottom line.
Closing remarks by Nilesh and then Mukta ma'am. But before that, I will just tell that those who have participated have got enriched with the today's session. We are having Dr. Harish Shetty again on 20th, but the topic will be entirely different. So it shows his inputs on a different issues on a different perspective. Today it's on mind and personality development. Then that day, we are having gender violence and workplace harassment. So it shows the spectrum of knowledge, the insights, the way he can think. And then on 21st, we are having on mental health law and disability law. And that day, we have convinced Mugdha ma'am to give her insights along with Dr. Shetty. So the way Mr. Nilesh has the vast knowledge, after the session, I will request him to join on any of those two sessions, because he has also had workplace as well as the disability to thought to law itself, other issues also. So two inputs from Nilesh and then Mugda, then we will wind up the session for today and we will catch up.
So I don't think you are interested to close the session at all.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. So we are winding up. Nilesh,
you want to go first?
I'm through. I'm over.
Yeah. Just one quick thing I would like to say to everyone, including sports people, is we generally tend to really keep on holding on to whatever has happened in the past. We keep saying that, you know, this shouldn't have happened, that shouldn't have happened. So my only say as a sports psychologist, generally I say is have great learnings from what you've experienced in the past. Take the takeaways from the past, and past is something which you cannot really change, but what you can change is your future. So take the takeaways, work on those, and try to change your future, because that is something in your hands, rather than feeling sad and getting depressed about what you couldn't change in the past. So that's just one maybe a takeaway for all of you which I can give. Yeah, Nilesh, on to you.
So I think the best part is never say never again. You know, it's always that, you know, in sports, we always believe that there's always an opportunity around the corner. And remember one thing, you know, those who think that, you know, we can start pointing fingers, there are three fingers pointing back at you. If you start taking that as a responsibility, you will stop pointing fingers at somebody else, because you start taking the responsibility of the rights and the wrongs, what you have experienced, for your own improvement, for your own betterment. And the moment we realize that, you will start becoming a different person for your own improvement. And this is what sport taught me. This is what sport has given me. And I always looked at failure as an opportunity. I always looked at failure as an opportunity to learn and improve upon, which has helped survive, sustain, even during this pandemic, because if a lot of people get negative thoughts, but it's sport which has given me remembering those good moments and making sure that I want to repeat those good moments the moment we resume. And that's, for me, is an opportunity for all of you to start thinking positively rather than thinking about the negative aspects.
Thank you, everyone. As Dr. Shetty said, that Dr. Shetty is clapping, probably, I don't know, for the fact that I'm closing it, that he's feeling so excited that we are closing it at last, or whether he enjoyed the session. But as Mr. Nilesh, and after the session, I felt one thing, that you have to look the positive. So I think that he has enjoyed. I will not ask him to say that, probably he's saying clapping, thank God it's closed. So tomorrow we are having a session, back to law, as we say, that invariably we take one session in our sessions, which is beyond law. That is why we have kept the topic of beyond law. Tomorrow we are having Honorable Mr. Justice Pratibha M. Singh on intellectual property's rights and its relevance during pandemic. Everybody knows on intellectual property's right. As a lawyer, she was a par excellent lawyer. Everybody used to try to engage her. And now having insights from her would be a different thing. And on 20th and 21st, as we said, we will be having Dr. Harish and Mugda, and I'm quite convinced Mr. Kulkarni has said, never think of no. No means next opportunity. We will take him on the board on 20th or 21st. Thank you, everyone. And I will say Dr. Shetty to give a vote of thanks from us, because I feel that he's a part of us. Thank you.
I think that getting diverse people across the country to debate on one issue makes the topics very rich. And as my teacher said once, that for mental health, that mental health is too important to be left to mental health professionals alone. We need the entire country to join hands and share insights. And that, I think, what you have done beautifully. I'm really grateful to you for inviting me. I'm so happy to hear from Nilesh and Mugda. Mugda, we meet very often in Bombay. But I think I have become richer with all these insights. I bless your efforts, and I feel that more diverse people from diverse backgrounds should be invited, so that the learning becomes a very, very broad and very insightful. Thank you.
So thank you.